Hi, I'm Andrew, and this is Blaster Breakdown. Today I'll show you how I turn this into this. And this is what I call the Chronobluevader. It's a standard flywheel upgrade with new cage, wheels, and motors, 2S lipo, voltmeter activated by the jam door, LED replacements, blue for green, and Chronobarrel integration. I first saw Welcomer 7 do this a few months back and thought that's something I have to try. This one actually belongs to my wife Anna. You can see her using it, some footage up here. The wiring's a bit interesting on the inside to have everything work together. So let's have a look inside and see how I did it. And so here we have the Evader in pieces. The only parts I've still got in the blaster are the voltmeter and the switch, only because they're glued and epoxied in place. And of course the switch is connected to the flywheel motors and cage assembly. And this is the part of the Chronobarrel that sits in front of the flywheel cage. So this is a new Chronobarrel, of course. It runs on two AA batteries. And this works by having an LED and a detector on opposite sides of the barrel, and that detects when a dart passes through. And from the length of time it takes for a dart to pass between these, the Chronobarrel works out the velocity of the dart. And so here's what the inside looks like. One pair of wires on each side for the LED emitter and the detector. You can see them a bit clearer there. And you can see I've extended the original white and yellow and grey wires with JST connectors. And here's the display of the Chronobarrel glued to the top of the magwell. So just like Welcomer 7, I cut around the base of this top part and then gradually ground it down until it matched the profile of the top of the magwell, which is on a slight slope. As you can see, it looks pretty clean, and I made it as level as I possibly could. There are three pairs of wires that I've routed inside the shell. Two go to the dart detector front barrel section, and the third is to power the unit. The wires that power the unit go to a buck converter first. This is a set 3-volt one inside a bit of heat shrink glued into place. And the reason that I used these JST connectors was exactly for this purpose, so that I could take the shell apart without having wires connected all over the place. I bought these on eBay. I think they're only a couple of bucks for 10 pairs. I think they're 22 gauge, but they don't need to carry much current, so that's not a problem. This is a buck converter from a worker kit. This one's adjustable, but you can get ones that have a set voltage. And these take your input voltage down to another level that you need for a particular reason. In this case, I want a steady 3 volts to power the Chronobarrel. So red and black go to the lipo. White and grey go to the Chronobarrel. Now the inner barrel of the Chronobarrel is quite a bit thicker than the standard Nerf faux barrel. So after cutting it to the correct length, what I needed to do was grind down and sand the outer edge until the outer diameter matched that of the usual 19mm faux barrel. Of course, both the stock barrel attachment inner part and the flywheel cage outlet are both designed for that 19mm faux barrel size. Now that took a while to get just right, but in the end I managed to have both parts, front and back, fit together nicely. Moving on to the flywheel cage, this is an OFP 42.5mm cage printed by Dean at BlasterTECH. It's got the Worker Smoothe flywheels and Fang Revamps. This spacing provides 8mm of crush, which results in a nice 140 or so FPS with the community darts that we use at the Brisbane area Nerf group events, without being too rough on this shared resource. Just focusing on the 16 gauge black and red wires, you can see it's a standard single switch setup between the lipo and the motors. With an XT60 connector, of course. And here is the other JST connector that brings power to the chronobarrel. And I've actually got the positive lead of that attached to the control board that's stuck on the back of the battery tray, just because it was easier to do when I was doing it. This board and the front half of the one attached to the flywheel cage connects the front and the back LEDs, and also has the resistors required to operate these built in. If you connected LEDs to a power supply at 6 or 7.4 or 8.4 volts, they'd just pop, so I definitely needed to keep these as is. The front board also connects to the flywheel motors, so I've basically cut it in half and only kept the forward piece that I needed. I've hot glued it to the cage, just as that's a convenient location. The Evader has 6 LEDs, 3 5mm and 3 3mm size. There are 2 of the 5mm ones stuck into these light tubes at the top back, and the third at the bottom front. 2 of the 3mm ones are attached to the front barrel attachment, and these can shine forward when a barrel piece is fixed in place. And the third goes into this diffuser piece that sits inside the front hand grip. Replacing the LEDs then is as simple as snipping off the green ones and soldering on the colour of your choice for the same size. When working with LEDs, you'll see that one leg is longer than the other, and this should always be the positive side. You can check this by holding them against any 3-volt coin battery, which also lets you make sure the LED actually works before you solder it in place. Now the face of the voltmeter I've just super glued in place. It's all clear, so no need to cut a hole there. And I've wired the positive lead to the stock jam door switch. So now when the jam door is opened, the circuit is completed and the voltmeter gives a reading from the battery. And when the jam door is closed, it turns off again. Now for the fun part of beginning to organize the wires. This is the base plate that holds the pusher in place. It can also help keep some wires where they need to be. The magwell lock piece can also be used for cable management. And then the trigger and pusher pieces can be fixed in place. And there we go. Fitting the flexible light tubes is just a matter of sticking the correct 5mm LED in the end, and then getting them to sit down in the right place. Near the end at each location, there is a piece of plastic jutting out that the two legs of the LED straddles, and that helps to keep it in place. The lower tube goes in just the same, only there's an LED at both ends. And then we can fit the battery tray onto its mounting posts. And I'll just check that the cables are sitting nicely and the pusher still moves freely. I've got the front 5mm LED in place, and the 3mm one on the longest wire is the one that goes into this diffuser piece that sits inside the front hand grip. Also at the front here we have two more switches. The first one is the main LED switch that the foregrip trigger controls. So that's the main switch that turns all the LEDs on or off. And the second controls the two 3mm muzzle piece LEDs. If nothing is attached to the front of the blaster, then these will not turn on. But when you do attach something, that'll press down on that switch and enables those LEDs as well. And that leaves the final two 3mm LEDs that slot into the front muzzle attachment on either side. And then we can slot in the chronobarrel piece, which we've already trimmed to the right length and ground down to the right outer diameter. And then we can fit in the foregrip diffuser piece with the final 3mm LED. So that's everything connected, and we've just got the three JST connectors left ready to join up to the other side of the shell. And it's time to screw down the flywheel cage. And now I can connect a lipo and verify that everything that used to work still does. Of course, you shouldn't test a new circuit with a lipo, always use double A's. And there you can see the main LEDs, the front LEDs. And the flywheels going nicely. And if we open the jam door, the voltmeter works too. Next, I can connect the three pairs of JST connectors. 3-1 is obviously the power. And I just make sure the cable doesn't obstruct either the pusher or the magwell. And the front two, I've marked each pair of male and female with either horizontal or vertical stripes, just so that I can ensure I'm joining them up in the right way. And then I'll just make sure everything sits nicely, the wires don't stick out. Test again with the lipo, and then I'll screw it all together. The Evader is already fairly long, so I want to just like say short butt piece here instead of a longer stock. And the last thing I did was shorten the front barrel piece just by cutting it short and gluing in the attachment ring on the inside here. And there we go, the chronobarrel works, the LEDs work, the voltmeter works, enabled by the jam door. And most important of all, the flywheels work. Okay, so now I'm going to test putting 10 darts over the chronograph. These are brand new Worker red full lengths. And I'll call out the value on the chronobarrel at the same time. $150. 158. So the Chronobarrel's reading a few FPS higher than the Chrony. Now I've got a theory to explain this difference. The Chronobarrel is calibrated for full-length darts, and everybody knows that if you use half-length darts, then you'll get an FPS reading about double what you'd expect. So I got the calipers out and measured a full-length red worker dart and a white Elite Hasbro dart. And here's what I found. The Elite dart was 74mm, the worker 72. And if we multiply the Chronobarrel readings by 72 over 74, the result is within a rounding error of the expensive Chronograph reading. So maybe the Chronobarrel isn't as inaccurate as a lot of people presume, including me, once you take into account the actual length of the darts being used. Let's go to a firing demo. Unfortunately, by the time I came to film this in the afternoon, the wind had really picked up. It's taking darts left to right at about 10 knots. And here we go, firing 22 full-length worker reds, just as fast as I can. Well, the wind took a few, but I think that's a pretty decent spread under real-world conditions. So there you have it. That's the Chronobluevader. LED replacement, Chronobarrel integration, flywheel upgrade running on a 2S LiPo. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. Please leave any questions or comments below. I'll see you next time.